a Conspiracy is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network. For other fun programming, please check out Alberta Podcast Network, where you can find shows like Bollywood is for Lovers. I'll take a drink of water. Maybe I'll run that again.
Welcome back, everyone, to It's a Conspiracy. This is the podcast where we lay out the beliefs behind selected conspiracy theories, alternative accounts, legends, myths, and more. I'm your host, Andrew, and I do not claim to be an expert on anything we're going to discuss today, and will probably be wrong about everything as usual, because I've been trying to work from home recently while simultaneously keeping an eye on my kids, and it's really hard to concentrate on what you're doing when, like, the rescue bots or the Wizards of Waverly Place are, like, banging away in the background. What? And I'm torn. I've had a rough day today. The potty training nightmare continues at my house, and I just, yeah.
Hey, man. Hey, don't worry. Yeah. You'll get it eventually.
I'm working on it, but I'm not the only one in the house.
Don't beat yourself up. You'll get there.
One step at a time. So this is it's a CINEMASPIRACY, the deaths and ghosts on films, which just rolls off the tongue. If you'd like to see where we dug up whatever slick bits of celluloid we're going to discuss today, then please zip by the resources in the episode description. Charlie slaves away in the hot sun day by day and reviews the dailies by night, making last-minute adjustments to get the crews in the morning to make that magic happen. Ooh. It's a glorious process, and he's just a lovely person, just a real nice guy.
Oh, you're too kind.
And I love your shirt, man.
Thank you. Isn't nobody else can nice? See it. This is an audio podcast. But thank you.
You can hear it.
You can hear it. It's so loud.
I can hear it. And we are a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network. Yay.
Wow.
You can check us out online at our website, itsaconspiracypodcast.com, our Twitter, at Is It A Conspiracy? That's run by the Irish Madman, who's come into combat with the Judas podcast late over our vinyl episode.
I'm good not old exactly Twitter sure. beef.
Yeah. My first Twitter skirmish was the other day, and it was with our own Twitter person.
You're like playing amongst our own team.
Yeah, just you know, yeah, inside the house.
You're learning.
The Facebook group, It's a Conspiracy, and then we have our Instagram page, It's a Conspiracy Podcast. That's run by Gorgeous Greg. Our email and our Patreon page, patreon.com/
It's a Conspiracy.
How do you slow down
every time now?
We got it. All right.
Practice next time.
Joining the online distance communication time today is Charming Charlie and our friends, Breanne and Emily, from the fantastic podcast, Emily Missed Out. So, ladies, thank you so much for joining us. We're so happy to have you here.
Hey, thanks for having us. We're excited to be here.
Yeah, always happy to talk ghost things.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so excited. I can't. I've been sitting on this for a while. And everyone's just going to interject as they see fit and just chime in and derail wherever and however you want to. And I'm so glad we can do this as a team, because friendships, the best kind of ships are the friendships.
Oh, yeah.
Now, ready then, Charlie.
Climb aboard.
With a yes or no, can you tell me if you've heard of any of these theories, Charlie?
Yeah.
10 cursed movies.
Oh, yeah. Are there actually 10 cursed movies?
Yes. Yes,
you know, there are. You with counting? Sure.
Yes, okay. There are 10. Number two, the guy that probably died in Ben-Hur.
Ooh, no, I don't know.
Okay. Number three, Munchkin Suicide.
Ooh, I think I know that one.
Okay. And then number four, we have Breanne is going to share something with us. So, Breanne, what did you want to share with us tonight?
I'm going to look at the Ghost in the Window urban legend from the 1987 comedy Three Men and a Baby.
Hey.
Yeah.
Ghost in a Window. And Emily, what are you gonna share with us?
I have some stuff about ghosts who have showed up in photographs over the years.
Are we talking about like Patrick Swayze, Demi Moore, like early 90s?
Emily knows who these are.
I do know. Yeah, I'm like, is Emily going to know any of these movies? No, this is a little bit less cinematography. Oh, no, I can't pronounce words. Less movie stuff, more just like photo stuff, since I don't know enough movies still, even after Breanne has educated me somewhat.
Have you seen the movie Ghost? Like, we should just get this out of the way right off the bat.
We did it for the podcast.
We watched it for the podcast.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Because,
There needs to be more ghost conspiracies about Ghost, but there wasn't enough there. I was sad.
Mm-hmm. Greg was going to do something on that about that, how that movie is now haunted by the ghost of Patrick Swayze. And we were like, oh, that's a little on the
dark. Oh, interesting. Yeah.
So.
Charlie's shaking his head. No.
Poor Patrick Swayze.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so we might as well get into this here. So this is subject number one, 10 cursed movies.
I found a cadaver!
So number one, The Passion of the Christ from 2004. This is directed by everybody's favorite super friendly guy without any problems at all, Mel Gibson.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This visceral display of Jesus's time leading up to his crucifixion is a bit of a hard watch. And actor Jim
Caviezel.
Okay. Yeah. It's hard to say. So I just started writing Jimmy C after that.
Nice.
He later shared the emotional experience left him somewhat traumatized. And this could be due to the fact that he was struck by lightning twice during the making of that movie.
What?
Yeah, he was struck by lightning two times.
What are the chances?
Yeah, dressed as Jesus.
That's a pretty traumatizing movie anyway.
Yeah, crazy.
I've seen part of that movie.
What?
I could not watch all of it. Yeah.
It's visceral. There's a lot to take in there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Jimmy C. later turned down a number of offers to appear in other New Testament-themed projects, and allegedly he was quoted as saying, "I don't want to be bloody struck by bloody lightning anymore. The last one got me right in me bum." So, yeah. And he's British.
Did he actually say bum? Did he say that?
Right in me bum.
Are you ad-libbing? Yeah.
He didn't specify where he was struck by lightning. But it's pretty clear it was in his bum. Because if someone doesn't say where they got struck, it was somewhere where they're like,
It's definitely in the bum.
Yeah.
If I've seen lightning bolts strike people, generally, it's in the bum.
Yeah, it's right. Or, you know, somewhere covered by your bathing suit, you know? Okay, number two, Rebel Without a Cause. Have you guys seen Rebel Without a Cause?
Long time ago, yeah.
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 In classic Emily stylings, no.
You haven't seen it. Okay. Now, this one is odd because it was James Dean died like maybe before it came out. So he died shortly after it was filmed for sure in a very mysterious car crash at the age of 24. So he was only 24 when he made that. And then Sal Mineo was who's the other guy in that. He was killed by a mugger outside of his home. Under very suspicious circumstances, it may have been like a contract killing, which
Whoa.
Is, yeah. And then a couple years later, Natalie Wood, and these are the three leads in the movie.
Yeah.
Natalie Wood died in what was initially deemed an accident. And then years later, people were like, no, that was like a straight up, like at least manslaughter, probably murder.
Wow.
And it's still an open case. So yeah, real weird. So the three actors in that movie, all three of them died in like, weird, like it was this, but it was that, like a mysterious car crash, a mugger that might have been a contract killing, and a boat accident that was actually like a whoopsie daisy, we murdered you.
cursed.
Yeah,
is that something murderers often say? Whoopsie daisy,
whoopsie doozer,
just a slip of the bomb. I don't know,
slip of the chainsaw, just right in your tummy. Okay, now number three, and this one is the one that I got scared when I was writing, and I was like, I don't want to include this anymore.
Keep the lights on.
So yeah, and I'm in a dark room, and yeah, okay. This one's called Rosemary's Baby. Yeah. Have you guys seen Rosemary's Baby?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Nope.
Okay, Emily, I'm just going to assume.
No.
Yeah.
It's the safest.
So this one is really real scary. The plot of the movie is basically a young actor sells his soul and kind of that of his young wife and their baby so he can like get an acting career, which is, just he's like, hey, my wife and my baby, I want to be in the movies.
Yeah.
Well, most people do it, I think.
I think that's how Tom Selleck got his start.
Tom Cruise, at least? No?
Yeah.
the Toms in general.
The Toms in general.
Any Tom. Yeah, Tom. Yeah. Maybe not Tom Hardy. That's a handsome man. He's too hard to be.
You know?
Yeah, yeah. Good point.
The movie was directed by that tiny little super creep, Roman Polanski. And it happened to come out the same year he married actress Sharon Tate. So shortly after the film's release... was when the Manson family targeted Polanski, broke into his home one night, and Polanski himself was actually the target, but he wasn't there. He was like out doing something, and Sharon Tate and a group of friends were there, and the Manson family got all gruesome and just said some weird stuff, and then they just did some crazy stuff. Also, I don't even want to get, it's gruesome. It's real gruesome. We'll put some links in. You can look at it.
They just did some crazy stuff. Don't worry about it.
Sad story. Oddly, the film's composer and... This name is spelled KRZYSZTO off.
How does that sound when you put it all together?
So his name, I'm just going to say
Giver.
Kurtzberghoff.
Yeah, Kurtzberghoff.
Kurtzberghoff.
Oh, I love that the spelling included an off.
There's so many Dargon. Kamida. He hilariously died a few months later at the age of 38, and he was the composer. So everybody's dead. Everybody that's in hilarious. That movie's dead. Real funny stuff. Yeah.
Cursed.
Number four. And actually, some of the people have said that Roman Polanski's career was cursed because he directed a film version of Macbeth. And people say that that's cursed. And he's like, oh, kirsch, schmirsch. And then look what happened. So, yeah.
Yeah, don't mess with Macbeth.
That's right. I feel we're supposed to say like the Scottish play or whatever it is. I don't know. Yeah. I hope we're not cursed now, okay? If we are cursed.
Thanks a lot, Charlie. Andrew. Thanks.
Take Charlie.
Thanks for having us.
We're going to have nightmares now.
And this one's a little heartbreaking. This is number four, the incomparable Atuk. And this one was actually never released. So this is the only movie on our list that actually hasn't been made. And it's Canadian. So it's launched into production a number of times and never made it because of all the curses. So it's just so curses. Cursed. The incomparable Atuk by Mordecai Rickler. What a great name that is.
Yes.
Is the story
that's
of an
amazing
Inuit.
Amazing name.
Yeah, totally. Mordecai Rickler. Oh, come on, man. He's obviously a super villain. He wrote
right?
a story.
Like if you name your baby that, you know they're going to become a super villain.
What do you want to call him? Oh, Mordecai.
Mordecai. Mordecai. Yeah. Oh, Mordecai. Turn off rescue bots. It's time for lunch. That's that's hardly a baby's name.
Finish your homework, Mordecai.
It's the story of the Inuit poet who travels to Toronto and has a series of wacky fish out of water experiences akin to the doctor show that Billy Ray Cyrus was on in the early 2000s. Do you guys remember that? Billy
no.
Ray Cyrus was like a country doctor.
Achy breaky heart surgery.
What?
I don't... Were you holding on to that joke?
That
was really he was like good. A real heart. He was like a country doctor, came to a big city, and everyone's like, oh, what's with your folksy wisdom? And he's like, oh, you know, little red wagons up the hill or whatever.
What?
Yeah.
Yep. I have never heard of this.
No.
It should have been called Achy Breaky Heart Surgeon.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was called. I think it's called Billy Ray Cyrus Runs a Hospital. Yeah.
That definitely sounds real.
Went into so be literal.
The script that was written was said to be crude and hilarious and a perfect star vehicle for a comedian comfortable with the old slapstick and banter. John Belushi, hot off of the Blues Brothers, which is an amazing movie, was eager to play the role and was involved in the original production. So it was actually him that kind of like saw the script and he got it going. So he dies of a drug overdose. Then Sam Kinison was offered the part, and he shortly after that, he died in a drunk driving accident. And then a few years passed, and John Candy was offered the part, which he would have made directly after Canadian Bacon, and he died of a heart attack shortly after that. And then the story caught the attention of the minds behind Tommy Boy, and they tweaked the story so it would have two leads. So it was offered to two Saturday Night Live veterans, Chris Farley and Phil Hartman.
Aww.
And shortly after it was offered, Chris Farley died of a drug overdose and Hartman was killed in a murder-suicide.
Stop giving people this role.
Apparently.
Put it away.
That is wild.
Yeah,
shove it.
That's a whole bunch of people. I mean, it's a series of choices except for the murder-suicide thing. I don't think you choose that, but...
Yeah.
Okay. Our fifth and final entry. I know there were supposed to be 10.
There was supposed to be 10.
This one's called Antrum. And this is alleged to be a found footage movie from the 70s. And the claim is that this is the most cursed movies of all time curses. The story revolves around a documentary showing a documentary detailing two young boys. This gets a little sad. They're digging a hole to revive their recently deceased dog. So the dog dies.
Oh.
They bury the dog. And they're like, oh, he's still alive. They dig him up. And they accidentally, like, whoop, they dig a hole that goes all the way to hell. And all the curses come out. So this story, it's rough. It's rough. Oh, this story is so cursed that everyone who watches it dies. In fact, many have reported to say, you don't watch Antrim. It watches you.
Oh, man.
Wow. Yeah. Come on.
Scary. 60 people have died watching Antrim. So that's what they say.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
Okay, now I actually do have one more. I had to include this. Okay, so here's our... This is number 10. We'll just say... Okay, so this is the movie, The Transformers, the movie. Okay. 1986, Hasbro were moving away from the traditional toy line, like the thing that had kind of got them off the ground with the Transformers, and they figured it would be a bold marketing move to release a film featuring all of the beloved childhood characters and then have them all brutally murdered in the opening scene of the film. Like, I don't know if you guys have seen this or not.
Oh,
but
it is. I haven't, but someone showed me some clips from this because
really?
They were telling me about it. And I'm like, that sounds wild. I'm like, why is Transformers suddenly so dark? And yeah, it showed me. I'm like, it's crazy.
They stay dead. This isn't like a Antrim, like you're digging up your dead dog and it comes back to life. Like this, Optimus Prime died and he turned pale.
Yeah.
Oh, so anyways,
it's not like the superheroes where they die and then just immediately are back alive for plot reasons.
they're
dead now.
Yeah, later on, one of the robots gets like blown apart and they're like, we'll put him back together. He'll be fine. And I'm like, why didn't you do that with Optimus Prime? Like, what the hell? You have
right?
this, like, screw Ironhide or whoever it was. Like, anyways, just rough. I'm still not ready to talk about it. Like, it's still fairly
that's
close
fair.
To the... okay, so the curse in this is that the Autobot Spike, and again, this is a kids movie, uses a curse word. So I'm just going to go ahead and show you guys some real cursing here.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Be prepared.
And I know you're both ladies, so I don't want to have any potty talk around you two. I hope that's okay.
It's okay. We can talk potty.
It's all good.
This is the scene.
I don't know
where,
if I can do this.
Yeah, Spike. No, it's not the scene. I'm not going to do that to you guys. I'm not
okay,
going to be the Optimus thing.
I have no emotional attachment to Optimus. I
do.
I can live with it either way.
Anyone with a heart. So, yeah. Okay, so here we go. This is the curse words in the movie.
It isn't even dented. Oh, shit. What are we going to do now?
Did you guys hear him?
Oh, shit.
Yep. Oh, shit. What are we going to do now? Here, I'll put it back one more time.
Oh.
Robots swearing. And my parents took me to see this movie. I was still crying. And later on, my mom was like, I can't believe he swore. And I'm like, I can't believe Optimus Prime is dead.
It's like, come on, mom. Important thing.
Oh, shit. What are we going to do now?
Yeah.
Hmm.
So shame on the Transformers. Anyways, that's...
The curse.
That's 10 cursed movies.
Such curse.
Yeah, so many curses. Yeah.
Almost made 6 this time. Almost.
we can fill in some more curses if you really need to.
Oh,
we know some words.
Okay. So we have here this is subject number 2, the guy that probably died during Ben-Hur. Avada Kedavra. Okay, so you guys are going to have, I'm going to set the scene here for you. Okay, drunk, waving a gun around, being Moses. These are the things that we think of when we think of the swagger, legend, and yes, mythos of Charlton Heston. He was a Hollywood icon in an era where you could do things that would immediately have you canceled by today's standards. And he was certainly an actor who never let an actor's credibility suffer for the sake of a dollar, especially in the Planet of the Apes sequels. Just all about quality. Charlton Huge Balls Heston played the title role in Ben-Hur, a truly sweeping epic of a slave reclaiming his freedom. A big part of the film centers on a chariot race, and legend has it that a stuntman was killed during production and the accident was left in the film on full display. And the director was like, oh, it's a tribute to this stuntman. And the stuntman's widow's like, what the hell is wrong with you? Like, why would you leave that in the movie? And apparently the family was bought off and the director was like, it's just a tribute. Like, I, you know, whatever. It's not because it's exciting. I just really wanted to pay tribute to this guy. And yeah, so the widow was like, that's not cool at all. So if you guys, I'll show you the clip here.
Not cool, guys. Not cool.
Not cool. Yeah,
not cool at all. What you're going to watch for is it goes by real quick. There's a part where there's a bunch of chariots and the horsey show is going around the corner and there's a couple of guys standing there.
Up to no good.
And yeah, so a couple of Roman soldiers. One of them is roaming out in the path and gets the chariots right over his legs. So you'll see him here. Let's
wow.
See this stuff.
They didn't have CG then.
No. Yeah, so apparently this is really him just with all the death.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Roll him.
Okay, and actually, I do got to say, like, I mean, I'm a movie nerd, but this, aside from all of the death, this is amazing. So this is like the late 50s.
Yeah.
And it's just incredible. So I'll start it a little earlier so we can see the whole thing. And you guys will know the part. I'll stop it after we see it. There it was there. I don't know if you guys caught that or not.
I caught the guy face down in the dirt.
Yeah, he
yeah, that was pretty apparent. That wasn't off to the side or anything.
No, it goes by so quick. The first time I saw it, I was like, no, and then I had to rewatch it. Okay, I'll just play this one more time here. And that's an amazing stunt too. Like, that's incredible.
Wow.
Okay.
Huh.
Yeah.
Wasn't that also okay? So, the thing that I remember about Ben-Hur is, weren't there allegedly either streetlights or a car or something like that left in the background when they were recording?
Not the chariot scene, but there's scenes in the beginning where Charlton Heston is like, Charlton Huge Balls Heston is up on the roof of this building and he like leans on something. He's like, oh, we're just off to womanize all the night and drink some whiskey. And like he pushes over this block that like falls on this guy crossing by, and that's the crime that he commits. And so in the background there's like an old Porsche or something.
Oh, whoops.
Oopsie. But just Charlton Heston just kills me. Like I really like Moses. I like the Ten Commandments. I even like Ben-Hur, but at the beginning of Planet of the Apes, his monologue at the beginning of that, I'm like, ugh, like, turn it off. He's just like, oh, but it's so many women. And it's so gross.
Oh, you're not a Planet of the Apes guy?
I'm a Planet of the Apes guy. I just don't like his beginning monologue. Like when he's like,
you're
ripped out his brain, you bloody baboon. I'm like, oh, yeah. But like the opening part, I'm just like, no, man, that's not cool. Right. Like, just be nice to people. You know, that doesn't cost anything.
Tisk.
Okay, so we'll come back to this as well. But yeah, that's just some grisly chariot death right there. And that's going to take us to ad number one.
Oh.
This episode is brought to you by Taproot Edmonton, your source for curiosity-driven coverage of our city, cultivated by the community. Taproot has launched a service to answer your questions about Edmonton's response to the COVID-19 pandemic and our experience of it. The idea is to help you understand this complex and quickly evolving topic with succinct, well-sourced answers to any questions you might have. Find the COVID-19 microsite at taprootedmonton.ca. That's taprootedmonton.ca.
Nice.
Okay. All right. So add this subject number three, Munchkin Suicide.
Hooray!
My favorite.
Yeah. It's the funnest of all the suicides, right? Like, so The Wizard of Oz had a plagued production for a number of reasons, and Judy Garland's story alone is just a trial of pushing someone to great lengths for the sake of entertainment. Just, she was treated really badly in that movie, and the bad treatment kind of went around to all of the cast and crew. The Munchkin Suicide refers to the urban legend that during filming, there was a record number of little people that were brought together to play the Munchkins in the production. One of these actors fell in love with another, and unfortunately the love was unrequited.
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 And in a dramatic fashion, the actor decided to take his own life, and the suicide ended up being in the final take of the movie.
Hmm.
So, yeah, I know. This is really dark stuff. So when Dorothy, the Scarecrow, and the Lion are singing, we're off to see the wizard, and they're walking up the golden sidewalk, you can see this guy swinging from a tree because he hung himself. Okay, so on that cheerful note, you guys ready to see some Munchkin suicide here?
Let's go to the tape.
You guys are great because we're like, hey, we all just met. It's like really nice to like see you. And then like, here's a bunch of really grisly stuff.
Let's talk about Munchkin suicide. All right.
All
the
right.
Best way to get to know someone.
Yeah. Yeah. What are your feelings on Munchkin suicide, huh?
The deep end.
Okay. So this one is really quick. But when they're going to be dancing around, and if you look sort of on the Scarecrow's side of the road, just in front of him, just above him, you can see, like, the dangling figure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The wonderful wizard of Oz. Here's the wizard of a wizard, if ever a wizard there was. If ever, ever a wizard there was, the wizard of Oz is one. Because of the wonderful things he does. We're off to see the wizard, this is the wonderful wizard of Oz.
So I thought it was supposed to be that thing in the back there.
We can watch it one more time.
Yeah. The wonderful wizard of
Oz. Here's the wizard of Oz. If ever a wizard
there was, the wizard of Oz is one. Because of the wonderful things he does. We're off to see the wizard, the wonderful wizard of Oz.
So you can see that the figure was like kind of moving or like swaying.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's the Munchkin suicide. We can talk more about what happened with that, but we'll come back to that at the end of the episode. Okay. And that's on that happy note, that's going to take us to ad number two. We should do ad number two in like a cheerful Munchkin voice.
Oh, no.
Today, I want to tell you about ATB's new podcast, The Future Of. Join Todd Hirsch, ATB's Vice President and Chief Economist, as he connects with special guests who offer unique and useful perspectives about the future. Explore how our economy and communities can not only brace for change, but embrace the opportunity it creates. From the future of women in business to the changing nature of work itself, The Future Of helps us understand what's coming and what we need to do today to get the tomorrow we want. Featuring two episodes each month, plus bonus episodes, The Future Of includes interviews with top community and business leaders from Alberta and around the world. Subscribe to The Future Of in the Apple Store, Google Play, Spotify, and everywhere podcasts are found. And connect to ask your questions about the future by emailing thefutureof@atb.com.
Oh my. Okay. Okay. So, Breanne, are you good to go? We can.
I can try here. Yeah. I'll try my best. I'll try my best to make this make sense. And you guys can cut out whatever you don't need. Okay. So, it's my turn?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So, little context for Emily and anyone else not familiar with this movie.
Thank you.
Yes. We didn't mention, but Emily and I we do a podcast where we're trying to educate Emily on all of the movies that she missed, all the references, the tropes, the fun quotes, and all of that good stuff. So let's see if I can give you a little bit here, Emily. So it stars Tom Selleck, Steve Guttenberg, and Ted Danson. Tom Selleck, I think most people would know as Magnum P.I., but I feel like you might recognize him as Monica's boyfriend, Richard, from Friends.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, sure.
Okay. And then Steve Guttenberg, most people I think would associate with Police Academy. Are you guys in with that?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But he's been in He's popped up most recently in like Sharknado and Lava Lantula, which I don't know if you guys have heard of this film. I looked it up. It is a tarantula that spits lava. Yes.
I hate it.
I didn't know that I needed that until I heard that just
right
now.
Like,
I didn't know that I didn't need that until right now.
By the way, yes, okay. There's Ted Danson. Most people I think would tie to Cheers, his character from Cheers, Sam Malone. But I'm thinking, Emily, you would know him as Michael on The Good Place.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Okay. I know some of these people. Cool.
Yeah, and this movie was actually directed by Leonard Nimoy, who is the original Spock from Star Trek. Yeah.
No way.
Yes, way. I know. That one blew me away, too. So this movie is about three bachelors who must figure out how to take care of a baby that's dropped off randomly on their doorstep. Not so randomly. One of them has fathered this baby. Like, fairly lighthearted plot. Like, lots of room for comedy. Yeah? Uh-huh. Okay. So... the urban legend goes, there's this scene in the film where Jack, who is Ted Danson's character, and his mother, played by Celeste Holm, are moving from one room to another in Jack's apartment, talking to the baby Mary. And as they walk into the one room and past the window, there is nothing abnormal to be seen there. But as they come back past the window, you can see what looks like a boy standing behind the curtains. And the story is that there was a boy that died in the house where they shot the film. And his ghost can be seen in this scene. So,
dun, dun, dun.
I'm so excited.
I'm gonna share this clip with you guys. Unfortunately, there's not a high resolution video available of this.
Favorite VHS.
Yeah.
Just like you.
You know, you boys live like pigs.
Oh my. Look there. Isn't she beautiful?
There she is. I'm gonna pick you right up.
Oh, I'm in awe. I mean, look at you. You pick her up like a pro.
I pick her up like a grandmother. That's called experience, darling. Let's see you.
So they're gonna come past it, and it's gonna, you're gonna look on your left hand side.
Mary.
Mary.
Do you guys see it?
Yeah.
Did you see it, Emily?
Oh, so great.
Right over here.
Yeah, just like me. Oh.
Yeah.
That's creepy.
Yeah. Okay.
Super
creepy. Yeah. When you catch that. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Yep. For sure.
And it's extra, it's always creepier when it's kids. Like when it's like just.
Yes. So we're coming back to these at the end,
the
you said?
The creepy ghost things are the creepiest things, yeah, definitely, like the ghost kids and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
It's like, why that? Why that?
Yeah, just, but yeah, no, we'll come back and explain this in a bit here, because that one is amazing. That, what a good call, Breanne. Yeah, that's so good.
All right.
Okay, so Emily, what have you got for us?
Oh, yes, my ghost photographs. Yes, I don't have audio stuff, but I do have some pictures.
Sweet.
Maybe I will pull that open too and screen share. Let me get the setup quickly, sorry. Oh, yeah, so you mentioned, I think, about... You're like, what people do you have ghost pictures of? How about Abraham Lincoln? Yeah. So spirit photography started in like 1860s-ish. And there was this photographer named William Mumler, who's thought to be the first person to capture a spirit in a photograph. And then he went forward to make a business around photographing people with their dead relatives.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
That's interesting. And Mumler. What a great name, again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he comes up a lot when you look up any sort of spirit photography stuff. It's like, yep, it's Mumler. That's a guy. Yeah, so former U.S. President Abraham Lincoln. Right. You can see him. I think this is supposed to be his wife is sitting there. And then you see this faint image of her or of him behind her and just like with his hands over her shoulders. Pretty weird, pretty creepy.
Mm-hmm.
Is and isn't.
Yeah.
Ooh. Okay, so there's also this. Yeah, this is one of the other ones that I thought was really creepy. Is this one's called The Brown Lady of Rainham Hall. Yeah, so there was one person who saw this apparition descending the stairs as the photograph was being taken, and the negative and everything of the photograph was found to be untampered with. Yeah, so they're like, it's a ghost, man. And yeah, it's a staircase, and there is a very ghostly looking, like, cloaked lady sort of in the middle of it.
Just going downstairs, going to get a snack, you know, yeah. No big deal.
Yeah, just ghost things doing things for ghost reasons. Don't worry about snack. It.
Just like ghosts do.
I love that I'm talking about ghosts while like in my very dark closet. It's very
there's a great ghost place in here to be with talking me right about now. Ghosts. Oh no.
Yeah,
oh,
for sure.
Boy, look at this one.
Yeah.
Oh yes. What? This one I meant to get to last because I'm doing kind of like chronologically.
We can come back to it if you want to.
This works too, because okay. This is the last two are like modern era stuff. Have you guys heard about Slender Man? Yes. So there's lots of stuff about lots of lore and mythos around this Slender Man character who's this like tall, spindly figure. Who's wearing like a suit and has like weird tentacles or something coming off of him. There's definitely photographs with him.
That is
definitely
really
no Photoshop happening, right?
Yeah. it's like the many arms and no facial features that make him so terrifying.
It's so creepy. Yeah. Okay, this is personally the one that I think is the creepiest.
Oh, okay.
This is the creepiest one. And this is like, yeah, like modern photography. I think this is 2005, this article says. Yeah, so this photograph was taken in Hampton Court Palace in London. This 10 or 12 year old girl took this picture of her cousin, and then the next day when they looked at these photographs, there's like a second figure. That's like
wasn't there
the super tall, like, would you guys say like 8 foot tall?
Yeah,
weird.
She's for sure,
like, lady real tall. Dressed in gray that looks like she has like super long hair lurking behind this woman. It's super, super creepy.
Yeah, like it looks head on the chandelier. That's how.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's not like, it's not just like a ghostly, like, oh, hey, it's kind of like light and spooky here. No, like it looks like a person.
It has color and it has like hair sticking out of the top.
And like not hands, but like weird, like, I don't know, asparagus arms that are going to like kill everybody.
Asparagus
arms. He looks like a villain from The Matrix, like a straight up.
This is the first photograph in this article from the BBC that I'm getting these from, and I'm like, this. I was like, is one of those people not supposed to be there? Because what the heck? I do have one other thing, which is, have you guys heard of the orbs phenomenon?
No. Mm. Oh.
Yeah. Awesome.
So it's this thing that happens in photographs where, looks like there's just little like light orbs floating everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And people say that they're like ghost orbs or like spirits floating around. Oh.
So not that just the light reflecting, but like they're ghosts. Like that's all the babies coming back to.
The spirits floating around doing spirit stuff. So yeah, like less like looking like a human figure, but yeah, these weird just like glowing light orbs that are maybe ghosts. It's kind of creepy.
That is creepy. Yeah.
So do you guys want to hear my personal ghost story?
Oh,
I went to school and it was haunted?
Like, yes.
Oh, I love it. I'm so excited.
Yeah. So I did an illustration diploma at a private art college that at the time was in the Mercer Warehouse downtown in Edmonton. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys know, like, the Mercer Tavern and stuff downtown is in that building as well.
Yep. Warehouses sound like creepy places. Yeah, sure.
They
good
are.
Start. Good start.
Yeah. I was told that, like, this warehouse burnt down a bunch of times. And, yeah, our teachers were telling us about how one time when this warehouse burnt down. Yeah, it's like used to be a warehouse, was converted into other building use now. But, yeah, supposedly when it burned down once, there was a horse in it that died.
Okay.
And that now there's like a horse ghost in this building that like lives in like, 'cause it has like an old like creepy freight elevator.
Right.
And I have been in this building at night working late on projects, and there's just like, there's definitely creepy sounds.
Do you hear like
maybe
like there are weird
yeah,
like a little bit. There's definitely like creaky upstairs sounds that I'm like, I don't know what that is. So that is my own personal ghost story.
Old freight elevators, creepy warehouses.
Yeah, that there's a lot going on there. You know.
Yep.
And like horse ghost.
A horse ghost.
See, that's the part I like the most. If a horse ghost had a TV show, would it be called Dr. Dead?
Okay, so all right, let's. We usually do this little thing where we're like, oh, it's opinion time, and we like try to like stick our opinions on things in here. But with this one, I was thinking we could just be like, here's what really happened.
Yeah.
So,
explanation time.
So for the horse trampled Roman soldier.
Yeah.
So it's very clearly a dummy. If you watch the footage again, first of all, okay, so Charlton Huge Balls Heston wrote a book called like In the Arena or something like that of his life. And he's like, between bottles of whiskey and all the good times. And he mentioned nothing about anyone dying on the set or anything like that. And people always asked him about it. He's like, no, not that I can recall.
This impression.
He was drunk all the time anyways.
Recall, so, but yeah. I guess you never know.
Yeah. You know, the only thing he recalled was like guns and how to be a crazy old guy. But he's a bad guy. Like, anyways, we're not going to. So we're in opinion time. We can just slander the dead.
Let it go, buddy. Let it flow.
I know. So if you go back to the, that chariot flip is so good. Oh, man, this movie's excellent. So if you watch that again, just watch the way the guy's legs.
They're like wooden.
Yeah. Like you can tell, even the way he falls down.
Yeah.
Like he does like the Flintstones thing where there's no knees.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So if you watch the footage again, so a human body would have been just all crushed organs and pulverized bones like a big bag of soup. It wouldn't have been like a sticky dummy with legs poking up that the horses were like, hey, I got no problem running over you. Because that's the other thing is horses probably wouldn't do that. Like they,
I feel like people get trampled by horses.
Yeah.
But that makes me feel so much better.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad I never got trampled by a horse ghost.
Yeah.
Getting trampled
horse
by
a ghost. That's another thing. They'll trample you. They'll trample everyone you care about. They'll go to your house.
So afraid.
That is so scary, a horse ghost.
That was so this was a dummy though. This reminds me of one of my favorite things of the late night show Married with Children. You guys remember that one?
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
They used to do this bit all the time where someone would fall out of a second story window and they would hit the cement patio just outside the patio door. And it's always a dummy and it's always the most fake thing. And it's always so hilarious every time, you know.
From that show. I'm going to have to check it out now.
Oh, it's hilarious. Anytime there's like a dummy thrown into like a trunk of a car or like thrown at like a Super Dave Osborne kind of thing.
A building or something. Yeah. It's hilarious.
It's so good. But this was like a better dummy than like a normal one, but they used a dummy.
Good.
The fact that the story about the widow, like that never happened, and the director was like, we did it on purpose. It's supposed to look scary. Like it's supposed to look like the guy was, you know, to use the pun again, he was roaming out into the path and the horse is just roaming over him because they're going to roaming him. Yeah.
Just movie stuff.
Yeah. Just it's scary movie stuff. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this one's a little bit more of an actual controversy. So back to the light world of Munchkin Suicide. The story goes is that the true story is that the set was full of big birds to give the whole thing a very otherworldly appearance, and you can see the birds all over the in all over the movie. And in that scene, not even the guy swinging from the tree apparently, but there's birds everywhere. So the remastered version shows that there's like this big kind of ostrich or something like that, and it's hard to see in the original one, but when it was remastered you can clearly see this bird like kind of like flapping its wings for some reason, probably because somebody dressed as a scarecrow was like running towards it. So it's like, get me out of here. I'm gonna get my wings out.
Are you saying it's a legitimate real deal bird?
Yeah, it was a real bird. So we'll just go back to this.
Yeah, it's not a bird ghost.
Yeah, it might have been a bird ghost. Might have been yeah
but like as opposed to like say Big Bird.
So I'll show you guys.
Big Bird showing up in the background of Wizard of Oz would also be very creepy. Let's be real.
Oh my god,
so creepy. So this is the original one here. Because of the wonderful things it does. Just hanging, yeah, hanging like an old sack there.
Yeah.
Okay, so yeah, real sad. Okay, then we go to. Okay, so what actually happened was, this is the remastered version from later on, and you can see everything much better. Like the original, the one that we first watched was the color version, but it was colored by like people in the '60s. So. God only knows what they were using, like magic markers on actual film. So this one's like properly colored, and you can see all of the details. Like if you look at the metal, what's his name, the Axe Man, the Tin Man, sorry,
the Tin Man.
Yeah, you can see a lot more of the rust and the detail on him, and you can see the sparkle on Dorothy's shoes, things like that. So if you guys look where that Munchkin was lamentably hanging, it's clearly a Big Bird.
Really?
In this version here. Yeah, just go ahead and watch it and all.
Okay. I was not expecting birds.
No.
Yeah, I know. It's weird. It's this. And if you look around in the scene, there's other birds just kind of wandering around. Did you guys see it right there?
Wow.
Oh, that's totally a bird.
That's totally a bird.
Yeah, so.
There's no way.
Wow.
And then it brought its head back up and was kind of like eating something.
No way.
And then
way.
The closer they get, the bird's like, okay, the scarecrow's coming at me, so it's wing time.
Right away. Because of the wonderful things he does.
We're off to see the wizard, the wonderful wizard of Oz. Yeah. Huh.
So now the conspiracy here is that a lot of people were like, and this is all over YouTube, they're like, no, the original version, that was someone who committed suicide.
That didn't look like the same thing to me.
It didn't look like the same thing. So they were like, when it came out in 98 like, or whatever, they had redone it. Yeah.
Huh.
So the conspiracy that lingers is like, did they Photoshop a giant ostrich back there to cover up for like what actually happened? And yeah, so and the sad truth is that like little people at the time, I shouldn't even say at the time, right up until now, they're treated terribly in movies and stuff like that. So you know, it wouldn't be out of place. Like the guy, I should look up his name really quick before I say this.
Well,
I hope
it's birds.
It's not a bird guy. The guy that was the most famous.
No, not that it's a bird guy, but that it's a bird and not a guy.
Yeah.
It's a much nicer reality.
We're going to accept the bird theory.
It's more fun. It's a more fun fact if it's birds, definitely.
Yeah.
So the guy that was Hervé Villachez, I'm not saying that right. The guy that was from the Love Boat, he was a villain in one of the James Bond movies. Do you guys know who I'm talking about here?
Yeah.
This is just a real sharing episode. That's really nice.
Sharing is caring.
Sharing is caring. That's, you know. Okay, let's see if I can. Okay, so do you guys see this guy here?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he's probably the most famous little person up until maybe
the Willow era.
Warwick Davis. And then after that, I would say who's been sort of eclipsed and really legitimized little people in film. The guy from Game of Thrones, I can't think of his name off the top of my head.
Yeah, Tyrion Lannister is the character. I haven't watched much of the show, so I don't remember the actor's name offhand.
Oh, I still know what Peter his Dinklage. Name is. Yep. Thank you.
Yes, there we go.
Yeah, so he was really, like, Peter Dinklage could not exist without people like Hervé Villachez or Warwick Davis or a bunch of other people. Like, there's, you know, I shouldn't, you know, and I don't know a lot about this, but, like, Charlie and I have a friend who talks about this quite a bit, and it's actually really interesting because he's been through a lot just for so that's the story, and nobody really knows. So the sad thing is that it might have actually
there might be some truth to it,
or it might have been just a real big bird that was just strutting its stuff and just got freaked out when the scarecrow walked by.
We're gonna go with bird.
Yes, it's very sad. I hope it is birds.
I hope it's bird.
I think it's the bird too. I think because remastering a film does bring out a ton of detail, and the fact that you couldn't spot it in the original one, it just looked like this like amorphous blob swinging.
Completely different shape.
And it's in a different space. Yeah. Like the thing was hanging between the trees, and that bird only flapped its wing once.
Totally. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
A little weird.
That's a weird one.
A little weird.
And that's why people, you know, continue to debate this, because they're like, you know, you guys just don't care and you just covered it up.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Okay, well, Breanne, what do you want to tell us about the scary little kid that shot himself with a shotgun or whatever it was?
Look, the ghost kid just really wanted to meet Ted Danson.
Oh, well, he does it, man. Ted Danson?
The boss. I love that guy.
Oh. Is the ghost kid also a bird? Because that would be amazing.
Sorry, no birds in this one.
This is going to be my new blanket conspiracy theory, is just that everything is secretly a bird.
It's an ostrich flapping its wings.
Birds.
Yep. Just gonna let
it's not real. It's an ostrich. It's fine.
Yeah, 9/11. I don't know. I think it was just a bird.
Just a bird, guys.
All birds.
Oh, man. Oh. Okay. I'm going to close this up with a quote that I grabbed from Tom Selleck on the Jimmy Fallon show.
Ooh.
Where Jimmy Fallon actually asked him about this little conspiracy. And Tom Selleck said, in regards to the story that the kid died in the house where they shot the movie, well, we shot on a soundstage. They built a set and all. So it wasn't true in the least. The figure that is actually seen in the window is actually a life-size cutout of Ted Danson that had been knocked over, which is why it's not his height. If I can share with you guys again, if I can make that work. Hang on.
Because he's like a baseball player or something in the movie, right?
No, he's an actor.
He's an actor. Okay.
He's an actor. So if you could, I don't know if you guys can see my mouse here for how long it'll keep working. Mm-hmm. This picture right here, he's actually standing in front of a cutout of himself. And it's actually the exact same cutout that's seen in this window. It's just that it's been knocked down.
Right.
And further away.
He's a tall guy.
Yeah. It's kind of interesting, though, that from far away, it looks like a boy hiding in the curtains.
Yeah. Well, it makes sense that, like, it's a person because it's a thing, a fake thing that's supposed to look like a person.
Yes. Exactly. Exactly.
So this was like a part of the movie that didn't make it in, because I don't remember that part in there, but like this was a part of the movie that was cut out or something?
That is what they say in the interview, was that this particular scene was cut out of the film. But they kind of keep the joke going that it was a ghost, just because it brings so much attention back to the movie still,
sure.
Right? Yeah.
Valid.
But yes, nothing spooky going on here at all.
Well, other than Tom Selleck's mustache.
Oh, it's not spooky. It's a great mustache.
It can be pretty spooky.
My mom had this calendar of Tom Selleck, and I remember seeing it as a kid, and I'm like, what's going on with that guy? Because it was like him in like super tiny little shorts, and his like thighs are just popping. And I'm like,
bronzed.
Is this what like the ladies like? Just like mustaches and like popping thighs? Just like pop, 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 pop.
At that time, I'm going to say yes.
Yeah, for
okay.
sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good to
know. I don't know. I'm pretty into birds.
Oh, feathers, not mustaches.
Yeah.
The thing that gets me, that the movie, there'd be times like I have my one of my kids with me, and they'd be like carrying them in a little baby pouch, and like they'd be like, oh, we need a diaper table real quick, or like a change table or something like that. People would be like, oh, it's a guy, he has a baby, blah, blah, blah. Like, it's so funny. It's just like
one
that.
One man and a baby.
And I'm like, man, just shut the hell up with that. Like, leave me alone. Like, point me to the change table and just keep your 80s mindset, you know.
Right?
Pants,
yes.
Right?
Like,
Yeah. Let dads brutal. Do dad stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's hard enough. And someone's like, oh, look, oh, you know, she's wearing like a purple shirt and like green pants. Oh, did daddy dress you? And I'm like, no, actually, daddy let her pick out her own clothes because she's a human being. And like, just because she's wearing things that look like shit doesn't mean that daddy dressed her, right? Like, just, you know, she wants to make her own mistakes.
Yeah, that's some rude assumptions right there.
Yeah.
And I
should assumptions.
How
I like
do you
that.
Really feel, though, Andrew?
Yeah. Oh.
Is this another episode of the podcast?
I've been hearing a lot of vendettas lately. That's right.
Well, see, now that we've been talking about curses, maybe we can learn how to curse other people. just putting that out there.
Right.
That's not a bad idea.
And I apologize for the bad feelings that Three Men and a Baby brought up for you. No,
and I shouldn't say that it's not that movie's fault. It's just that people are like,
oh, it's just like that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
These
guys, they don't know what they're doing. He's got a mustache.
Yeah. It's a bad stereotype.
It is. Yeah. But Steve Gutenberg is delightful. And, you know, mm-hmm. I can't hate that movie. Like, I try, but I can't. Yeah.
Again, Ted Danson, man. Come on.
He's so good.
Come on.
He's so good, man. Like, and he continues to be amazing. Like, he's just awesome. Every time you see him, you're like, oh, we're in for a treat. Mm-hmm. Dancing with the stars. Okay, Emily, what do you want to tell us about? Do you want to talk about some ghosts?
Some spirit facts?
Yeah.
About all the really super real ghosts caught on so as I mentioned before, spirit photography has been around since like around the 19th century. And the thing is, photographers were experimenting with new techniques such as stereoscopic images and double exposure. And some photographers decided to purposefully use these techniques to dupe clients for profit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, people are sad because relative has died. Well, now I can sell you a photo with your dead relative in it.
So you think maybe some of the people that had their pictures taken didn't know that they were like, oh, no, my grandpa actually showed up, you know, and they were like,
I want my picture taken with Honest Abe.
Yeah.
With Mumler, that first guy that I talked about. Yeah, like he made this whole business around photographing people with dead relatives. But eventually there was like a court case against him and he was like accused of like sneaking into people's houses and like, I don't know, all of this stuff. But yeah, people think he achieved his technique by inserting a previously prepared positive glass plate featuring the image of the deceased into his camera in front of some unused glass plate, which was then used to photograph his client. So that's the double exposure technique where the two exposures get put together and then it looks like there's a ghostly image on top of the photograph that he took with the live person. So that's like maybe bad. Like snuck inside people's houses to like get photographs of their dead loved ones. I don't know.
That's what I assumed. Yeah.
So like other people replicated this technique, but somehow he was acquitted of fraud, but he ended up going out of business anyway, just because people didn't believe him anymore.
Yeah.
Well, good. I mean, if someone's going to take advantage of someone like that, be like, I'm going to take like some nice old lady's money because I like, you're like, screw you, man. You suck.
Yeah. Well, exactly. Right.
Yeah.
Yes. And then, going back to that staircase photo, the brown lady of Rainham Hall, there's like one person who like vouched that they saw the apparition as the guy who's taking the photograph and like it wasn't found to be altered or anything. But it's thought that that image was created by the camera being shaken during a 6-second exposure. So it's like taking enough time for, enough of the picture to... Yeah, but I'm bad at explaining photography.
No, you're doing great, but that's because also there was the ghost in the picture, so the ghost probably did it.
Totally.
Yeah, the ghost shook the camera and did exposure things, but basically it boils down to it's a weird photographic thing that's not actually a ghost. There's people who know photography things figured some stuff out.
Yeah, I think it had something to do with because it being such a long exposure and having something pass by the camera in just enough time for it to catch a glimpse of it was kind of the idea behind that one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Also, who just takes, they're like, oh, an empty stairwell. What a neat picture.
Like, I don't know what exactly is up with that. Yeah.
Need backgrounds for stock photos, guys.
Valid. So the Slender Man, you think that was just like someone's like, we'll put a scary statue at the back of the boat or whatever that was? Or
I think that's straight up Photoshop.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the thing with a lot of like the modern stuff is just like, well, it's Photoshop. Although the one with that really creepy gray lady that looks like super, super real, that's actually like a weird thing from... Hold on, let me find my notes here. Oh, yeah. So digital cameras, and it says in particular in this article, smartphones take photos in stages. So in darker environments, the image sensors take longer to record enough picture information to form a photograph. And this is called image aliasing. and anything that moves through the shot during that time can appear distorted. So that's what this weird gray lady is supposed to be, is just like weird stuff happened in image processing, essentially.
It's just so weird because she's so tall.
Yeah.
Like, if it had been another person passing through.
You can tell that's like, oh, like, a dog ran through the thing, and so there's, like, weird dog legs everywhere. Yeah, that photo was, like, the one that, like, legitimately freaked me out a little bit.
Super creepy.
Did you say weird dog legs everywhere?
Dog legs.
Yeah, have you not seen the photos that are, like, a dog ran through the frame during, like, a longer exposure, and it's, like, a long dog with, like, a million legs?
No.
Yeah, like a panorama thing with, like, a centipede dog?
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, that happens a lot with panoramic shots, for sure. Because you take the picture, different times. So it's like that, but it's in one shot, and just the way the camera processes it makes weird stuff happen. That one's super creepy, though.
Mm-hmm.
And then the last one was orbs, which... yes, are a common visual artifact that's a result of flash photography reflecting light off of solid particles such as dust or pollen, or like rain can do stuff too. So, but lots of people are very convinced that they're ghost spirits, including my mom. So,
yeah.
I can't convince her. I can't convince her it's not spirits, but.
Be like, Mom, look, these aren't like the unbaptized children from hundreds of years ago or anything. It's not.
I'm like, it's photography things. And actually, I do have an end to my ghost horse story.
Oh, right on.
Yes, I know the origins of horse ghost.
Awesome.
So as I was saying, this was something that was happening when I was in art school. And one time we had this life drawing session that we were doing that like a bunch of people skipped out on. So our teachers were like, hey, the people who like actually showed up today, we're going to let you in on a secret. And I've been sworn to secrecy and I am breaking the secrecy. So hopefully no one finds out super secret, top secret stuff. My teachers made up horse ghost.
Oh, wow.
They made up horse ghost and they told everyone about horse ghost. And then everyone else started talking about horse ghost and it spread around. Which is super hilarious. But yeah, we were the only ones who showed up for that class that knew that horse ghost was fabrication. And we got to secretly know that in our hearts for the rest of our time at school.
Wow.
Did you continue to keep the myth going?
Oh, absolutely. I love horse ghost. Horse ghost is great.
It's so good. Like a horse ghost.
Just it's so
galloping
random.
Through the cafeteria, you know.
Sure.
Why a horse?
Yeah.
Why not?
But seriously though, that there was weird creaky sounds in that building at night, and there was like this weird creepy freight elevator that this ghost was supposed to live in, and I'm like, well, I hate being here alone in the dark now.
I think, you know, even a, like ghost or real, the thought of a horse in an elevator is like, that's odd. Like, that's a that's a pairing.
I mean, it
you're
was
like,
a
no.
horse elevator.
Well, I guess there must be a horse elevator, but you know.
Who knows? Yeah,
why do horses sure need to go to the fifth floor, though?
It was said that the warehouse like burned down multiple times. I'm not sure if that part is true or not.
Hmm.
That is great. Yeah. Horse ghost.
Thanks, Emily.
Yeah, that's my personal ghost story has come to a close.
Nice.
No one tell anyone that I ruined the secret of horse ghost.
Okay.
Secret is safe.
Very secret.
They'll bleep it out on the podcast.
Yeah, it'll just be a long just beep, 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 beep.
Like horse ghost is actually beep. And
actually be pretty good.
We'll make it seem like we lost the feed.
Yeah.
Horse ghost is
it's like what? I couldn't hear what you said, Emily.
And then put some horse sounds behind it. Like,
oh, that would be so great.
Yeah.
Actually,
come in here.
Oh my God, that'd be so fun.
I think I read a book about a horse ghost when
really?
I was a kid.
Hmm.
Okay, it was either a book about a horse ghost or a book about a dog ghost. And then whichever one it wasn't, I wrote a story about the other animal.
Oh, you...
That's awesome.
That is great. Yeah, I don't know. Either way, like a puppy ghost is... That's creepy too. Like that's scary. Or a bird ghost, like an ostrich ghost is you know,
oh, man.
Not quite a horse ghost, but ostrich ghost. Ghostrich.
two decades later, I will write that sequel of Ghost Ostrich.
Excellent.
Electric Boogaloo.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
That is.
Way to go, Emily. Awesome.
Thank you for bringing that. We, yeah. Oh, man. But do you guys have any thoughts on Charlton Heston or Charlie Shirt or...
Charlie Shirt. It is pretty great.
Thank you. I'm glad
that the guy that was run over by a horse was wooden. I'm hopeful that the hanging munchkin was a bird.
And I hope so, too. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I'm still creeped out by that tall lady photo that you had, Emily.
It's the creepiest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And we'll make sure that anyone checking this out, I'll get the link for that and we'll put them on the Instagram page and just super scary. Just sit in a nice dark room and put that on and
sit in your dark closet like me and listen to this episode and watch these pictures.
Don't worry about those noises behind you. It's fine.
It's fine.
Yeah, that's. Well, that was a nice scary way to warm up the squeaky bits in our frightful places. We really do appreciate you stopping by for a listen, and please feel free to rate, review, subscribe, tell a friend, tell your neighbor, tell your foes. Spread the good word like Roman soldiers on the horse track. You can check out all of our past casts and social media stuff at itsconspiracypodcast.com. And we will be back soon with our lunch meat special. And then season 3 begins in September. I am almost brought to tears thinking that season 3 and September are right around the corner. I just
almost brought to tears thinking that you went with my stupid lunch meat special idea.
I can't wait to do it. I've already started. Who knew that lunch meat was like the real hub of conspiracy theories? Like, I had no idea.
Oh.
Just spam. It's amazing.
Oh.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I have to listen to this.
So thank you so much, Breanne and Emily, for joining us tonight. That was great. You guys are awesome. And thanks for coming in.
Hey, thanks for having us. Yeah, fun episode.
It was a good time. And as always, thank you for listening, and please take care.
Bye.
Bye. Go.
Conspiracy. Megatron must be stopped, no matter the cost. You got the touch. You got the power.